I ain't gonna lie, this week we ain't starting with no fucking music. It ain't no point in being gleeful. It ain't. I don't even want niggas to get comfortable, cause it ain't even about to be that type of day.
Not at all.
Yeah. It ain't even about to be that type of day. I ain't gonna lie. If y'all would have, now I know it's about every week I say this, but if niggas would have caught me and we recorded Sunday or Monday after we watched film, I wouldn't have been as pleasant as I am going to be today. And I'm not going to be pleasant at all, really. So I'm just warning people right now, if you know, if you got a problem with profanity or you at work or whatever, put some headphones on or turn it off. Or turn it off, because I got a lot of shit to get off my chest. I'm going to go ahead and be honest with y'all right now, because I don't know what the fuck that was Sunday. Same as that problem as last week against Cleveland. Offense nowhere to be found. Stalling out in the red zone. Same issue we done had for 3 years now. But we gonna go by the notes, though. We're gonna go by the notes, cause if I start right now, it's gonna be hard to stop me. So we're gonna go by the notes. Welcome to FPFO. I'm your co-host, JJ.
I'm your co-host, Terrence the God. Welcome back. We're here for another episode. Let's go ahead and get it started.
Yeah. And transparently, if I gotta have this feeling every single week and have to come in and record, like I you know, it's gonna be very strenuous on me. Because when I tell y'all, and I'm gonna tell you what, another thing too. Cause my sickness began Saturday. My sickness began Saturday when I saw this report, these rumors on what the fuck is going on inside the organization. That's when my sickness really began. I'm going to just keep it 100 with you. Right? Now there are rumors from some random on Twitter. But that's neither here nor there, because if there's even a slight inkling that this shit is true, I'm back on the same energy I was about Matt Rhule last year. And really, really transparently, I'm already the fuck there. Quick summary real quick. Start by fucking the play number one. And this is how I know the game was about to be bullshit already. Play number one. We can't even recover it. We can't even get the damn kickoff. We can't even run the damn bitch back. We can't even touch the bitch back. Niggas want to bring the ball out, fumble. So the Giants already have possession on what, the 25, 26, something like that?
Yeah, they already in the red zone. They recover it in the red zone, so.
Fumble to kickoff number one, play one. Not even 5 seconds into the game, turnover already. Defense, though, of course, as they always do, like they've been doing the last 2 years, 2.5 years, they get a huge stop. You know, force a field goal. Same thing on possession number two. After OPI, dumbass OPI from Shaw, the nigga that we've been gassing up the past 2 weeks, thinking that he was going to play a huge part in our offense. Dumbass offensive pass interference. Some shit he didn't even have to do to win the route. So 3rd and 22, we run this little quick flare screen, whatever, some new shit that I don't know why we like running so much, because to me, we haven't had much success with it. We run a little flare screen. Robbie, because you know, he kind of light in the ass, and I'm going to try and be nice to the player. I'm going to try and be, you know, graceful to the players, because a lot of this shit is a coaching issue, if you want me to be honest with you. But I'm going to try, you know, cut him some slack. But Robbie is light in the ass. That nigga bully him. Take the ball away, so then they get the ball back again inside the 30. So off rip, we can't even establish no rhythm, no confidence, nothing. Cause niggas don't know how to protect the fucking football. Get another stop defensively. Force a field goal. So now it's what, 6-0?
Yeah.
Shh. Come out, third drive, we look halfway decent, 3rd and 9, Shaw Smith, quick slant. Nigga got 6, 7, 8 yards a cushion. Can't make the play. Turnover or drop pass right in his chest. One of the better throws that baked through all day. And it was, and those were few and far between, too. And we're going to have a conversation about that nigga today as well. Because, I mean, shit. We could have kept our draft picks if you asked me.
That's a fact.
If this what it was going to be.
I agree.
Stall out, kick a field goal, 6-3. Then offense again. We force a stop defensively. Offense again gets the ball, gets into the red zone. Fairly decent drive again. Get into the red zone, stall out. Because guess what? We're behind the sticks. Third down is about 3rd and 8, 3rd and 9. Every time. That's a story with this team already. This team already has their identity already. You know what I'm saying? The laughing stock of the NFL already. Already. Because niggas can't execute simple shit. Small shit. Win your routes. That's it. Win your routes, complete the pass. It's basic. But what I have to sit there and watch on a weekend, week out basis already, niggas creating their own pressure in the pocket. Niggas have time, but because they so jittery, for whatever reason, they forcing dumb shit. Or they got to throw the ball away on 3rd and 12, so we don't even have an opportunity to convert. Kick the field goal, go in the half. Then we come out. Defense does a hell of a job. Forces a punt. Go down, score a touchdown. So at this point, I'm in L house. I'm feeling great, nigga. We up 13-6. Like, yeah, we turnt now. Because defense been playing a hell of a ball game, right? But oh no. Because now for whatever reason, and I seen this with... I'm getting too much into the shit, Terrence, and too much into the show, so I apologize, because nah, I ain't even really let you say shit. But I just got to get this shit off my chest for real, bro. For whatever reason, this coaching staff and this front office and this ownership group, or not even ownership group, Dave fucking Tepper, all of these niggas, for whatever reason, they got ego problems. So it's like you either do it my way or the highway, even when we know some shit is working. The whole fucking game, once we sent 4 people or more, Daniel Jones' success rate decreased tremendously. For whatever reason, we come out and score a touchdown, and 6 plays out of the 8, 9, 10-play drive, we're sending 3 niggas. Make it make sense to me, bro. This is the type of shit we done had to deal with the past 3 years. 2.5, 2.25, whatever the fuck you want to call it. People act like they're so incompetent when the answer is right in front of them. And this is why I get so pissed off. This is why y'all niggas call me a hothead. Because it's frustrating as fuck. Because I got to sit here and watch it. Every fucking week, dumb shit. Give up a touchdown, so now it's 13-13, and then, you know, stall out offensively, don't get shit. C-Mac gets 0 touches. Defense does a good job first 2 plays. Then JC gets another penalty, which, don't get me wrong, JC had a hell of a game. But it's just like fuck, man. It's the same shit. And if this is, we just gonna sound like a broken record all year, man. You can go ahead and say what you gotta say. I'll just give a couple stats real quick. Then I'm gonna let you, you know, say what you have to say. And then we'll dive a little deeper into this shit. Cause that was just the beginning. Cause I have a lot to say.
Yeah, facts.
14-29 for Baker. 145, a touchdown, no picks. So it's good that he's protecting the football. But, I mean, I can take probably 3/4 of the NCAA, put them behind that offensive line with those weapons, and they're going to produce the same stat line. That shit is mediocre, but whatever. 15 touches for C-Mac, 102. DJ Moore led the team in catches, 6 catches, 43 yards and a touchdown. Robbie Anderson, 3 for 32. C-Mac 4 catches for 26 yards. Another issue, not getting him the football. But yeah, man, just go ahead and you say what you got to say, because niggas ain't gonna really want to hear much from me today, because I'm angry, already.
Yeah, I feel it. I mean, just to reiterate on what JJ said, like, yeah, we read some reports that came out Saturday, and it's just like the ownership, like the front office as a whole, is just shitty. Like, it's a shitty organization at this point. Like, coaches not doing their jobs. Like, people act like they don't have any authority in the front office. The organization just looks like shit. And it's translating on the field, because you can see it with the players. Because the stuff that's happening on the field starts with the coaching. I think that, to me, there was a lot of good takeaways from this game. Offense played like shit. We know that. Like, if you watch the game, you can see that. Same thing as last week. And if you go watch the pod from last week, I specifically said, if we want to win this football game, we cannot come out and start how we started against the Browns. And what do we do? Anybody want to remind me what we did? Chuba Hubbard comes out and fumbles first play of the game. First play of the game. Honestly, I don't even know why he's back there. But it's just, I don't get it. I don't get it. People just not doing their jobs, can't protect the football. So that gives the Giants the ball in the red zone, as JJ said. And then defense comes out and makes it stop. And so that's really the only thing that I can kind of like hang my head on this game, is that the defense played a good defensive game. But like, you can only do so much when you have a shit offense. No rest. And so we continue having the sub players in and out. And then like, the defense is not moving how they was moving at the start of the game. That's because they're steady on the field. They're not getting any rest. So yeah, like I said, Chuba comes out, fumbles first play. We don't recover it. I guess he just wasn't ready to fucking play, but that
to say the least.
Whatever that is. Defense gets a stop. We come back out second possession. And then Shai Smith, we gassed Shai Smith so much.
We were so happy to see that nigga.
I apologize to the fans for gassing that nigga. And if you knew how he was before he got here, then, hey, maybe you knew something I didn't. Because we gassed the fuck out of that nigga, and he is not that. I'm going to go ahead and say that.
Respectfully.
In order for you to be a good receiver in the NFL, you have to catch the ball. And the thing that I dislike the most about Shai Smith is he wins his routes better than, like, almost any receiver we have. But what the fuck does that do if you can't complete the catch? Like, that does nothing if you cannot catch the ball. And so, he comes out. He gets an offensive pass interference on a hitch route or a comeback route, whatever you may call it. Clear as day. Like, the man just shoves him. And if you're watching Shai Smith throughout the game, he's doing this almost on every route. Like, he's so physical coming off the ball that he's just like putting himself in position to get penalties that we don't need, because you can already see our offense cannot move the ball. So why are you going out here committing these senseless ass penalties, and then you're putting us behind the sticks? And so now we have Baker trying to battle 3rd and 22, 3rd and 10. Like, and if you go look at our stats, like, we average like 8.4 yards on third down. Like, as far as like how far we got to go on third down, 8.4 yards. Who the fuck is going to, like, nobody's going to convert off of that shit. And if you lose the third down, you're probably going to lose the game. If you lose the turnover battle, you're probably going to lose the game. What do? We came out fumble first play. That same possession, 3rd and 22, we threw a little pop pass to Robbie Anderson. His little ass got stood up, trying to fight for more yards. My thing is, why are you trying to fight for more yards on 3rd and 22? Go down. Like, we're already in a shit situation. We have a punter who's a pro bowler. Let him punt the fucking ball down the field. That's all you have to do. Go down. He gets stood up, gets ripped. They recover it. And then now the Giants are in the red zone again. But credit to our defense. Held them to a field goal. Defense held them to a field goal. And then we come back out. And I would say the drive that we came back out with is fair. And so, did we kick a field goal that?
Yeah, I think we made it 6-3 at that point.
Okay, so we did get a field goal at that point. And then defense comes back down, forces a punt, again, defense stepping up, playing the football that we know they can play, because we have a very underrated defense. I don't think they're underrated now. Like, I feel like they put the league on notice. Mm. And so they come out, force a punt. We go down. Baker makes a good pass to DJ Moore to get us probably a little bit further than midfield. Go down, make some more plays. And then DJ Moore hits him with a little corner route to the back of the end zone. Baker makes a great throw. DJ makes a good catch. He was wide open. So, honestly, I don't know how great the fucking throw was, but he was wide open. So, I mean, we score that. And then so the defense comes back out, and then we just shut the fuck down. And which, like, I mean, I'm not going to say I get it, but I get it. I'm not going to say I get it, but I get it. Because it's like, we have a great defense, but it's just unrealistic to expect your defense to make every stop, every possession on the field. And so they give up that touchdown, which I'm like, okay, it's 13-13. We're good. Like, we're good. Offense is going to go back down. They just scored. We're going to go back down. We're going to get a positive drive. And we're going to put the ball in the end zone. Like, I'm feeling good about how we're doing right now. Besides the offense in the first two drives, I'm feeling good about how we're doing right now. And then it just goes to shit, honestly. Mm-hmm. It just goes to shit. The offense can't get it together. Shai Smith, I just don't know what the fuck he's out there doing. Dropping passes left and right. Then he gets lackadaisical on his routes towards the end of the game. So, I mean, we just can't execute. We just can't capitalize. But I don't put all of that on the offense. I put it on coaching.
Right. And not to cut you off. The problem that I have, because you say it's understandable defensively, the problem that I have with that is the fact that you can say that it's understandable defensively, but if we watch the film like we both have, it's not. Because the issue is, niggas want to do stuff their way.
Yeah.
And niggas in this specific instance is coaching. That's why I don't understand it. That's why I can't shoot bail. I'll give bail to the players.
Yeah.
Because you can only do what you're coached to do. You can't just go out there and do your own shit. Especially not with this regime. Because we know what that'll land you. My issue is not with the players this week. It's with coaching.
I agree.
That's why I cannot agree with you in the sense that it's understandable, because it's not. If it was something like we were gassed or whatever, then I can say, okay, that's the reason why. Because our offense can't produce anything. We're punting the football. We're putting them in shit situations. Two fumbles, et cetera, et cetera. That's not the case. This came out of halftime. Everybody's rested up. It's 13-6, our first lead of the game. And we let them march up and down the field. And it's not because of a lack of, you know, effort. It's not because of niggas not making plays. It's because of coaching.
Yeah.
Because you want to decide that you want to send three guys on a rush, give Daniel Jones all day to sit back and pat the ball, instead of going to what worked the whole game. Every time, I'm telling you, we sat there and watched it yesterday. Mm-hmm. Every single time. And I broke it down. Every time. A four-man rush, we win every single rep. It's probably two or three reps that Daniel Jones dropped back to pass. We had a four-man rush, and he was successful. Maybe two or three times, and that's not an exaggeration, bro.
Yeah.
That's real shit. Maybe two or three times he was successful with a four-man or more rush. And for whatever reason, as successful as your defense was in half number one, you decide you want to change shit up in the second half and get torched. Just walk down the field. It's coaching.
Yeah.
It is coaching. And specifically Phil Snow. So stuck in his fucking ways. Because if this story is true, he feels like he runs this shit.
Yeah.
And transparently, why wouldn't he?
I agree.
Why wouldn't he? So, like I said, just on that point specifically, I just simply cannot agree with you. Because I don't understand it. I don't get it. Because I see the reps that we win. Already this season, 2 weeks in, I know what will cause us to be successful. And I know what will cause us to look like bullshit.
Yeah.
And that's when you send a fucking three-man rush and send nobody. Now, I'll give Phil Snow credit. He got a lot more creative with the blitz packages this week.
Yeah.
You know? He sent, you know, we got a lot more pressure on the quarterback this week. The issues that we were talking about last week, a lot of them, with the exception of the offense, were addressed.
Yeah.
One of the main things that I was worried about the most coming into the game Sunday against the Giants was punt team.
Because
I just knew Richie James was going to take one to the crib.
Yeah.
Based on the way we covered last week.
Yeah.
They played extremely well.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, he didn't even get a chance to return a punt. And if he did, it may have been one.
Yeah.
He didn't even get a chance to get any motion going at all because punt team was so good. Now, I know it's not – Phil Snow doesn't have a direct reflection on special teams. I'm aware of that. That's not lost upon me. But I just want to kind of point out some of the positives.
Yeah.
Because there's not many. And I have a lot to rant about.
Yeah.
So I just want to get some of the shit like that out of the way.
Yeah.
Defense, hell of a job. Like you said, I will agree with you that you can only do so much as a defense.
Yeah.
I will agree with that. You can only do so much when your offense continues week in and week out, drive in and drive out to put you in shit situations.
Yeah.
I agree with you there. But that first drive out of halftime or second drive, whichever one it was, I can't sit by and watch that shit without saying something.
Yeah.
Because we study this shit too much. I know the in and outs of this shit too much. I watch film too much to not differentiate between, is this a player issue and you not having the guys, or is this a fucking coaching issue? And simply put, the game Sunday was a coaching issue.
Yeah.
The whole thing.
I agree. And just to go back to my previous statement, I definitely think it was more so on the coaching than the players in itself. Because if you go and look at the stats, or you don't even really have to go look at the stats, just go watch the game. If you watch the game, Brian Burns had, I think he had 2 sacks, maybe 2 or 3 tackles for loss. And when you're sending 4 or you're sending 5, like, we have a very high success rate. Daniel Jones was very uncomfortable in the pocket when we sent 4 or 5. And we also played the run great. A big turnaround from last week. I think one of the statistics was we was the number one team in run defense this week. We was graded the highest number one run defense this week. And so that speaks a lot, especially when you take into account what happened last week with Nick Chubb and Kareem Hunt just ran it down our throat. So, I mean, I think defense played a very good game up front. And so that's why I really don't understand why is Brian Burns dropping back in coverage 15 times throughout this game. Can somebody please go show me a play where Brian Burns has played in coverage and went and got a pick, has played in coverage and went and broke up a pass, has played in coverage and scared the quarterback to where he didn't throw the ball in that area. I don't see nobody else on the defensive line that's going to go and get after the quarterback, that's going to get a good push on the offensive line to go and sack the quarterback if Brian Burns is not on the edge causing havoc. So I really didn't understand why he was playing in coverage for 15 snaps out of this game. That made no sense. And the times that he was in coverage, he looked like he didn't even know what the fuck he was doing. So it's like that looked like something that was just implemented this week in practice. So, and it's like, if you're going to do something like that, at least the player at least has to know what he's doing. Half of the time, it looked like he didn't even know where his assignment was. So it's like, why is he in Brian Burns' foot and hand should be in the ground every play. He should be going to get the quarterback every play. He's our best player on the defensive line, arguably our best player on defense. So why is he not going after the quarterback? Do we see Myles Garrett sitting in coverage?
Never.
So, I mean, I don't get it. That really threw me off. But I do think the Frankie Louvu, I apologize for Frankie Louvu because I came in here and shitted on him last week.
Yeah, man.
I'm not going to lie.
Shitted on my name.
Yeah, I shitted on him last week. But I think that was more so of my attitude towards the defense in the whole, because they did look like shit last week. And so nobody was getting to the ball and nobody was making tackles. But we did a great job in getting to the ball. Saquon Barkley did not have a big day.
At all.
We neutralized the run very good. He did not have a big day. I wouldn't even say there was a really big day in the passing game other than when we didn't get a pass rush on the quarterback. And so the defense played very good. Frankie Louvo in specific. I think he had 4 tackles for loss. He had a pass deflection. Almost would have been a pick.
Should have been a pick.
Yeah, if he had called that, then he might have would have cribbed that, and we would have been up a touchdown going in the half.
Yeah, and that was a doubt. That to me was a big moment in that game, because even if you don't get a touchdown, even if we get stopped short, whatever may have you, we're still up. We're still up 3-0.
Yeah, kick a field goal or something.
And I'm saying 3-0 just because that's how I think about the score. Tie the game up is 0-0 either way, no matter. I mean, it don't matter how many points are on the board.
Yeah.
Either way, like I said, we go up 3-0. Bare minimum.
Yeah, that's a fact. And I think the J.C. Horn played a very good game. It was times where I've seen a lot of people pointing out he got beat by Sterling Shepard. But that's just because Daniel Jones had so much time to throw the ball. And so it's like Sterling Shepard got behind him. But it wasn't a completion, so that really doesn't fucking matter, honestly.
Yeah.
So I think that J.C. Horn played a way better game than he played last week. Dante Jackson played a very good game. I seen him come up and make some great tackles. And I just think the defense played an all-around good game this week. And it's sorry to say that the offense just couldn't pick them up.
Yeah.
The offense just couldn't pick them up. And I would say that goes back to coaching, because there's no way that you design plays that can't get you down the field. Because I think the offensive line did a fairly good job in blocking this week. Because it was a lot of times where Baker had time to throw the ball. Baker had time to make some plays and throw the ball. And I don't know if people wasn't winning their routes. Of course, we had 2 drops by Shai Smith. But other times, people wasn't winning their routes. It wasn't shit open. The play call was shitty. So we just really couldn't get anything rolling. C-Mac did have, this was his first 100-yard game since 2019, I think. So that he did hit a milestone. I still didn't think he got enough touches. They didn't involve him enough in the offense, which I'm really so confused on that. Like, I don't understand what the deal is with Ben McAdoo. I don't understand what he's trying to do. And then it pisses me off even more when the coaches get in this press conference and then act like they can't take accountability for something, or act like they don't have any authority over the team, specifically speaking on Matt Rhule. Because he gets in this press conference, they're asking him questions, and he's like, oh, I don't know. I guess we're just going to have to put more guys in. I mean, did you not see that in the first half? Shai Smith dropped 2 passes. He's not winning his routes. Why is Rashard Higgins not playing? I don't understand. We went to training camp.
Yeah.
We seen the connection that Rashard Higgins and Baker had. Why is Rashard Higgins not in the game? And so that's something that I don't get, and it's something that Matt Rhule never has a fucking answer for. And so that's what really pisses me off about the coaching staff in general, because he's the head coach. The coaches, they follow what you do. They go based off how you go. If they see that you a bunch of bullshit, you get in here, you don't hold players accountable, you don't hold them accountable, then they're going to continue to run over you. They're going to continue to run the show how they want to run the show, and obviously that's not translating to fucking wins. So at this point, there's only one obvious solution. Get rid of that bitch. Get rid of the whole coaching staff. So, I mean, I'm not going to dive too deep into that. So,
yeah. I mean, I agree. I agree. Y'all know that I've come in here this year. The first 2 episodes that we've done, you know, we did the week 1 preview before we played Cleveland. Then we did the recap and the preview for this week. Y'all know that I've up until this week, I have forgiven Matt Rhule. I felt like a lot of the fan base was being unfair to him, not giving him a shot to be successful this year, you know, because we did know coming into this week that coming into this year, that Dave Tepper already made it abundantly clear that Matt Rhule would have another shot. So we should have been at peace with that over the offseason, that this is what we have to deal with. And to give the guy a shot, bringing Ben McAdoo, a couple of other guys in on the coaching staff that has had success in the past in this league. But I agree. I mean, unfortunately, it's Tom. Unfortunately, it's Tom. And really, it's not unfortunate because this is what we have to sit through week in and week out. And it's been the same story for the past 2 years. 2 years and two games. Every single week. And I totally agree with you that every time, and this was my biggest problem last year. Because like I said, bro, we study this shit. So we watching all of these press conferences, all of this shit. There's no reason why you should come into a press conference stating, quote, we have to give guys other opportunities, or we have to give other guys opportunities. You have the ability to give these people that you speak of the opportunities that you're talking about. You call the shot. So I don't understand. It's just so lost upon me, so befuddling that this nigga acts like he has no control. And this was my biggest thing last year. Always acting like he has no control over nothing.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, who in the fuck is calling the shots? Who is coming out with the final depth chart? Who's assigning playing time? Like, what is happening? Is it one of those situations where you know, you give that freedom to your coaches, to your coordinators? Because when you come in and say we had to give guys opportunities, and for me, outside of looking in, you're the one that has the potential to allow them these opportunities that you speak of. I just don't get it. I do not get it at all. So unfortunately, like I said, the answer is to fire Matt Rhule, like you stated.
You have to. And not to cut you off, but if you are leaving that up to your coaches, you're fucking 0-2 now. So from this point forward, I'm not leaving shit up to them.
Right.
I'm having to say so in everything. I'm not leaving nothing up to them.
Right.
Rashard Higgins sat on the sideline with his hat on all day. So that just gives me the impression that he came into the game knowing he wasn't about to play.
Yeah, because there was no helmet on his head.
Yeah.
There was no helmet in his hand.
So I'm confused. It wasn't even a helmet in sight. He came in the game knowing he about to chill all game. So what conversation did y'all have before the game? Why is he not playing? The reporter asked him, what's the deal with Rashard Higgins? Is it a play calling thing? Like, is it him not knowing the offense? Matt Rhule, oh, no. No, it's none of that. He knows the offense. So why the fuck is he not playing?
No answers.
Like, why is he not playing? And then he deflects the question. He always beats around the bush about the question. And then you get Phil Snow coming in the press conference just making these dumbass faces so nonchalant about everything. I'm like, bro, like, the coaches, they just have no passion. Like, and it reflects on the field. It reflects on the field. Because how they play on the field starts with the coaching staff. It starts with the coaching staff. And if they can't get things together in their little circle, then you're not going to have a good football team. You can't run a good football team if the coaches are not on the same page. And if Matt Rhule doesn't know why certain stuff is happening, if he doesn't know why Rashard Higgins is not getting in the game, if he doesn't know why we only sending three fucking people on the pass rush, like, then what the fuck is going on within the coaches? You don't have your foot in anything. They're literally just running around you doing what they want to do. So, I don't know.
Yeah. There's no leadership. And that's been the problem. And another thing I'm sick and tired of hearing out of Matt Rhule's mouth is that we're close. I'm so fucking sick and tired of hearing that. I've been hearing that since week 12, week 11 last year. I'm so fucking sick and tired of hearing that word close. Because with this team, with the weapons that you have offensively and defensively, at some point, close is not good enough. And that's the point that I'm at now. I don't want to fucking hear anymore that we're close. Because we've been close for fucking 30 weeks, according to you. I don't want to hear that we're close. At some point, you have to fucking win these games that you have a chance to win. We're not getting, it's not like we're coming out and getting the dog shit beat out of us. That's not the case. It comes down to a couple plays here and there. Motherfuckers not, you know, not executing. We decide to send three men out of halftime. We don't convert on an easy interception directly to our hands before halftime. Christian McCaffrey only getting 19 touches when the motherfucker is averaging 6.8 yards a carry. So I don't want to fucking hear anymore that we're close. I want to hear fucking accountability. But it goes back just to, I mean, it just proves my theory last year that this nigga has no control over what is going on. It's abundantly clear. If you sit and you listen to this motherfucker talk, he has no control over what is happening. And if he does, then that's an even bigger problem. Because if me and you can sit back and dissect this shit and see what the issue is, see when we're successful and see when we're not, and you as an NFL coach can't, or you can't put your guys in a position to be successful, that is an issue.
Yeah.
And it's a level of incompetence. A level of incompetence that I'm sick and tired of seeing. And then, like you said, we can never get straightforward answers.
Never.
We can never get straightforward answers. And I'm going to tell you another thing. With all due respect, if this motherfucker Chuba Hubbard comes out on kick return this week against New Orleans, I'm going to be pissed. You can't give the ball up twice. That's the reason why we're getting rammed in the turnover game. That and the fact defense can't generate turnovers for whatever the fuck reason.
Yeah.
But that's neither here nor there. I'm going to have a huge problem if you have Rashad Higgins, LaVisca Chenault, oh, and by the way, Christian McCaffrey on your roster, on your lineup, in your depth chart, all with the ability to return punts and or kicks. I'm going to have a huge problem if Chuba Hubbard is returning kicks again this week.
Yeah.
Because he generated nothing. And maybe it's a unit thing. Because the week before, Andre Roberts, whatever the fuck, that's his name, Andre Roberts?
Unfortunately.
Yeah. That nigga won't generate and shit the week before either.
Then goes before
he
hurt.
Went down. So.
Yeah.
So maybe it's a unit thing. I don't know. What I do know is that I don't want to see that motherfucker back there again. Really? Because my boy Jake, he said something to me before the season even started. He said, with Christian McCaffrey and Deontay Foreman both healthy and both having the ability to run the football efficiently, I don't want to see Chuba Hubbard get any touches, let alone 4, 5, 6 touches a game based on, you know, them kicking field goals or whatever, based on the fact that he's back there in the return game. I don't want to see Chuba Hubbard on the field at all. Really, because he's sorry. And I say that with all due respect. Listen, any of the players, y'all watch this podcast, whatever, y'all hear the podcast somehow, our frustration is due to the fact that we haven't been successful for the past 2 or 3 years. And all of this shit is being said respectfully, but it's being said from a business standpoint, not from a personal standpoint. Chuba Hubbard probably is a fucking phenomenal guy. But when you put them fucking pads on, I don't give a fuck about none of that nice guy shit. If you can't get the job done, you fucking sit your ass on the bench or you fucking go get a job at fucking Whole Foods. God. One of the two. One of the two, bro. I'm so serious, though. Like, you know, we can laugh about it now because it's been a couple days, so we've had time to cope. But I'm telling y'all right now, Sunday and even fucking yesterday, if we would have got on this fucking pod, I wouldn't have been as pleasant as I am today. And I know I don't sound pleasant at all. I already know. Because it's the same shit, the same story, week in and week out. year in and year out with Matt Rhule or a Matt Rhule-led team. Every fucking week, we have to deal with the same thing. And then, like I told y'all last year, the shit that pisses me off the most is the fact that we losing these games. And then I have to fucking sit back and listen to this motherfucker talk like he has no control over his team. Makes me sick to my stomach. Go back to a point that you tapped on, that you touched on earlier. We said last week, me personally, I said 22 to 25. You said 30. And with all due respect to the offense as a whole, you probably are closer with your number than I am with mine.
You give them 30, we win the game.
You give them 30, we win the football game. He's averaging 6.8 yards a carry, dog. That's what he did this week. 6.8 yards a carry. And he got what, 15 on the ground? 15. Then you don't send him, you know, out to catch any passes, run any true routes.
I don't get that, bro.
I don't get it either, bro.
I don't get that. How we utilize Christian McCaffrey his first couple years in the league, he was running the ball out the backfield. But he was also our most effective receiver in the pass game.
Right.
Because you put a linebacker in front of him, cooked.
They're fooled.
You put a linebacker in front of him, they are cooked.
And that's one of the things we talked about.
Exactly.
Last week, we specifically said, bro, these linebackers for the New York Giants cannot cover this nigga. Can't cover him. Not even a shot in hell that they can cover him. There's no... Bro, I'm telling you, if we would have sent that nigga out 15 times... Last week, he would have won 15 reps.
I agree.
Those linebackers are way too slow to cover Christian McCaffrey, if you don't know who we're speaking about. It makes no sense.
Yeah. To me, it looked like they were sending him on almost like dummy routes.
Which is outrageous.
Yeah, to get other receivers open, but they ain't doing shit. And you got a quarterback, he ain't really making no plays. So why is Christian McCaffrey coming out the backfield, jogging on a little fucking out route, whatever it is, a swing route? Like, that's not doing anything. And so if he can't be effective in the pass game, we ain't even using him properly in the run game. What the fuck are we doing with him?
Same.
What are
we
doing with
him?
Just like you said, if we have him, use him. If we have him, use him. He's our key to winning football games. When Christian McCaffrey is healthy, Christian McCaffrey can win you a lot of football games. Even if you got a shit quarterback back there. You get the ball out to him, he's going to go make two or three people miss. He's getting 6-7 yards a carry. So I really don't understand that. And that's, I hate having to say it, but it goes down to play calling. It goes back to the coaching staff. You know how many coaches in the league would kill to have Christian McCaffrey coming out of their backfield? And then we got him doing these little dumbass routes. He's not even getting the ball on. It's drives throughout the game where he doesn't even touch the ball. There should be no drive throughout the game where Christian McCaffrey does not touch the football. That makes absolutely no sense at all. There should be no drive where he doesn't touch the football. So I really don't get how hard that is to see for the offensive coaches, for the head coach. You can know the slightest bit about football and watch Christian McCaffrey and know that he's the best player on the field. You can watch him and know that he needs the ball every drive of the game. But for some reason, we're okay with sending him out there and not giving him the ball at all.
Yeah.
Leaving the ball in Baker's hands.
Yeah, in the fourth quarter specifically. When it's winning time.
Makes no sense.
The last drive or the second to last drive.
And he didn't
touch the football at all.
I don't get it. I really don't. I need an explanation. If anybody out there can give me an explanation, I need to hear it.
Oh.
I need an explanation. Because I don't get it. It's hard for me to grasp that concept. And I'm no offensive coordinator. I'm no coach. I'm on the outside looking in, but I can see that Christian McCaffrey is the best player on the field when he steps on the field. Therefore, your best player needs the football.
Yeah. And it's just a lack of competence when he doesn't touch the football.
Honestly.
I mean, that's all it comes down to. Because anybody that you ask in the NFL, any fan that you ask in the NFL, at the bare minimum, they're putting Christian McCaffrey in their top five running backs.
Facts.
And to me, that's being gracious. Because he is a top three running back, yeah. Bare minimum. And you'll get a lot of people in this fan base, including yourself, that may be biased, if you want to call it that. But you'll get a lot of people that will call him the best running back in the NFL. And really, you'd be hard-pressed to give me evidence that states otherwise.
Facts.
Honestly. So the fact that he's only touching the ball 19 times is just preposterous. What was it last week? 11, 12? Well, yeah. How many touches was it last week?
I think he might have touched it 14 times last week, I think, in total.
So 14, cool. We got a slight uptick with 5 touches. But when you come out and say before the season even starts that we're not going to babysit him, you know, we're not going to do this and that with Christian McCaffrey. We're not going to put any restrictions on his play. When you come out and say that as a head coach, and then 1 week he has 14 touches, the next week he has 19, he's not even cracking 20 touches. And I know a lot of running backs that are of lesser talent that are touching the football more.
Yeah.
It's really just mind-boggling to me. I can give you a prime example. Cam Akers this week for the Los Angeles Rams, after only touching the ball 3 times week 1 against the Buffalo Bills, touched the ball 18 times this week.
Is he a better running back than Christian McCaffrey?
Not even close, with all due respect.
Okay.
Not even close.
I thought so.
And he has, and also, by the way, he has another starting running back in the same backfield as him, in Darrell Henderson.
Pathetic, bro. It's pathetic. Honestly.
So I don't get it.
Yeah.
I don't get it. It's frustrating. It's frustrating. And I mean, because it's almost like we're saving them.
For what, though?
For what?
Running backs have a low shelf life. I hate that it is that way, but they just don't last long. That's a position where you just don't last long. And it's sad to say, but what are we saving them for?
Not shit. Because if you stay, I mean, if you stay on this pace, playoffs is not even a consideration.
At all.
It's not even a thought. Really, playoffs shouldn't even be a thought right now.
Winning a game should be.
That should be number one.
And that should be number one. Carolina is not an 0-2 football team. And so it's just crazy that this team will go to waste because of shit coaching.
Yeah.
This defense that we have now will go to waste because of shit coaching. So it'll be another season thrown down the drain. Because we don't have the proper personnel. We don't have the right coaches in place. And so I'm really not understanding what the owner is looking at, what the GM is looking at. I don't get it. I don't get how this man gets so many chances. Like you said before, y'all decided to pay him all that fucking money. Mm-hmm. Coming out of college.
With an 0-11 record against ranked opponents.
Pathetic. Because he could recruit. Good. Nice. He's not recruiting no fucking NFL players because nobody wants to go to a team with a college coach. Who the hell is he recruiting in the NFL? Who in the NFL is saying, I want to go and play with Matt Rhule? Nobody.
At all.
And so that should be out the window. I don't care who the fuck he recruited in college. This ain't college. And so how many chances does this man get before he's out the door? Because quite frankly, Matt Rhule shouldn't even been able to step off that fucking field. He shouldn't even been able to step off that field without getting a phone call. Hey, pack your shit. Pack your shit and find a new job.
Yeah.
We'll pay you the rest of your money. Pack your shit and get the fuck out of Carolina. That should have been the only conversation he had coming off the field. So I'm really not understanding it, honestly.
I mean, it's just, and we'll talk about this for a second or two. And actually, I'm gonna go ahead and bring the rumor story in. I'm gonna just read the whole shit.
Yeah.
But we'll break it up. But it's just mind-boggling to me. And just to go back to what you just said, you don't know what the owner is thinking. The only thing Dave Tepper is thinking about is his fucking pockets. And that's something that really pisses me the fuck off. Because this is the guy that came in, gave Ron Rivera, what, 1 year?
Yeah.
Maybe 2? And as soon as he finish this season one or two games under 500, you had the audacity to fire him.
Shipped him.
After everything Ron Rivera did for Carolina, after everything he had to endure, you got rid of him. Same thing. I forget who I was. I heard a clip on Twitter. It's the same thing with even the soccer coach. You brought this soccer team to Charlotte. Don't have any success throughout the first 2 weeks of the season, and you fire him because he wasn't resonating with the fan base. But then you come out of your fucking mouth and have the audacity to call your fan base just the fans in the basement that always have something to say. Yeah, motherfucker, we do always have something to say because we're the ones that are fucking signing your checks.
Facts.
The reason why you exist in Charlotte is because of us. Yeah, cool. You could read the stock market and you could predict the future on that side. But for some reason, that shit did not translate to the football side of things. All this motherfucker cares about is his pockets. That shit pisses me off because we saw it with Ron Rivera, shipped him. The soccer coach, the first 2 weeks of this nigga being in Charlotte, shipped him. But yet Matt Rhule, for whatever reason, time and time again, gets opportunity after opportunity after opportunity. It makes no sense. It's pathetic and it pisses me off. Because then you have the nerve to come out and talk about the fan base. The audacity of you, motherfucker. Yeah. Like I said, we're the ones that put money in your pockets. We're the ones that have to spend. Oh, because you wanted to increase ticket price $80, $90, $110, $120 to sit in section 515 at the fucking top of the stadium.
And watch your team get that shit blasted.
And get their shit blasted because the inability of your coaching staff to come up with a game plan and stick to it and to come up with some shit that works, we have to sit back and watch this shit. And yet, time and time again, only thing we're supposed to do is spend our money and just shut the fuck up. I can go ahead and tell you, I'm not the one. And right now, cool, my voice is, you know, it's not the largest. Not many people, you know who the fuck we are. But I think we speak for the entire fan base in echoing the sentiment that Matt Rhule has to go. And it's not just Matt Rhule. It's Matt Rhule, it's fucking Ben McAdoo, and it's Phil Snow as well. Because the audacity for you to disrespect us this offseason, when the only thing you've done is come in, change our field, which, oh, by the way, that was a recruiting point in itself because a lot of people love playing on natural grass. And there's been numerous instances where you've seen prior Panthers come out and say, yeah, that was one of the bigger reasons why I decided to go to Carolina was because of natural gas. Natural grass. So the only thing you did was come in, rip that up, so you can put fucking concerts in there week in and week out when niggas should be practicing in that bitch. Now, I know we have our own, you know, practice, our practice field or whatever may have you. But I say that just going back to when Eddie Pinero got signed and Matt Rhule pretty much said that he had no opportunity to kick in the fucking stadium because there was concerts going on all week. So that's the only thing you've done. Put turf on the field, brought a mediocre MLS team, fired the nigga that gave you, you know, some of the best years Carolina has ever seen, and failed on a fucking headquarter plan. Cause by the way, we didn't forget about that either, Dave Tepper. Since you want to have the audacity to come out your mouth and be disrespectful, we didn't forget about how you nutted that away. Promise all of this shit down in South Carolina. you know, one of the best practice facilities, one of the best headquarter facilities. We didn't forget about that shit.
Pathetic, bro.
How you dick that shit away since we want to talk and come out of our mouths and be preposterous and be disrespectful. So if that's the game that we're playing, let's talk about you, motherfucker. Because yeah, you may think we forgot, but we didn't.
Shit is crazy. I agree.
It's crazy. So let's get into this rumor shit. Because I definitely got to tap on this. And I'm going to read the whole thing. So y'all just bear with me. Because it's lengthy. But when you hear this shit, if you haven't heard it or seen it or read it already, when you hear this shit, I'm sure your stomach will turn just as mine did.
With another one, high and I gas up another one. Next to my bad bitch, another one. Living like Khaled. Yeah, back with another one, high and I gas up another one. Next to my bad bitch, another one. Living like Khaled. Yeah, 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 yeah. Living like Khaled.